Amen. Well, I trust that the spirit of worship has been in Elgin with Andy and Lindsay and with Luke and the worship team down in Niles as it's been here in Rolling Meadows today, just very honoring to God. And now we're going to all on each of our campuses turn our attention together to God's Word. You know, I want you to know and hear from me that I believe so strongly that there is a harvest of souls coming into our church in the next weeks and months. The Bible teaches that we've been through a real season of refining. I know that I feel like I have been personally, and our elders feel this way. And John 15 says that he that bears fruit, he prunes that he may bear more fruit. And God has not wasted any time with us, not in any way. And the scripture says that the fields are ripe to harvest. And I hope that you begin to pray and to believe that we are going to be winning men and women, people you know right now who do not know Jesus Christ, people around you where you work in your neighborhood. Men and women are going to be coming to Jesus Christ. And I believe this with all of my heart. And I believe that our study in the book of Acts is preparing us for that. See, popular today, very popular today, is the idea that to win people to Christ, you have to become like them. That's how you win people to Christ. You got to become like them. You got to be able to relate to them. And Christian leaders around our country and around the world are waxing eloquent about cultures and how to reach them, and cultural talks and cultural insights. And you got to understand your culture if you want to reach it. You got to be able to relate to your culture. Some of them are telling us that we have to compromise to reach the culture. That all this talk about Jesus and the cross and the reality of a destiny in hell and a fallen man who needs to repent. And man, people, they don't want to hear that. And you gotta kind of cut the corners off that. You gotta soften it if you want to reach people. Some are saying that. Some are saying you gotta comfort people if you want to reach them, and you gotta give them lots of time and don't press anybody about the urgency of the gospel and the necessity of being saved. If you press people, they're not going to, you got to kind of not just soften it, but you got to slow it a little bit and just slow it down, give people lots of time, don't make anyone uncomfortable. And then also very, very popular today is the notion that you got to be cool if you want to reach your culture. And that's never been a big problem for me, but some are suggesting that if I really want to be able to reach people for Christ, I should, you know, kind of dress down a little bit and come out in a pair of jeans and some groovy clothes and sit on a stool and drink Snapple and have a little chat about Jesus with everybody. Yeah, that's going to be happening soon. And, of course, these ideas are everywhere. And the problem is that they're not in God's Word. They're most definitely not in the book of Acts. And the people who are winning thousands to Christ in the book of Acts were not compromising the message. They weren't softening it. And they weren't comforting the message. They weren't slowing it down. And they weren't, most definitely were not getting all cool with the message to sell Jesus to people. And the goal of the message today, if you're here and maybe you have a hard time believing that Jesus Christ is the answer for our culture, maybe you struggle to see how the message of Christ can really penetrate such a dark world and the things that are going on in our world, if you struggle to believe that, I want you to know the goal of the message today, it should be a real encouragement to you. Today should just be a real a blessing and a renewing of your confidence that Jesus conquers all of these things in our culture. He doesn't comfort them or get cool with them or get strategic or subtle about it, but he just absolutely rules over the predominant characteristics of our culture. The title of the message today is Confronting the Culture. Confronting the Culture, and I pray and believe that it's going to be a real a blessing and an encouragement to you. So let's take a moment and let's bow together and prepare our hearts to hear God's Word. Father, thank you for the privilege of being here today. Thank you for the joy of taking your Word into our hands. Thank you for the power of your Spirit that lives within every redeemed child of God, that we can know your truth and understand it and be changed by it. And we pray today, God, that you would bless us and encourage us and strengthen us in our commitment to be bold with the good news of Jesus Christ. Use your Word to stir that in us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, Acts chapter 18, kind of where we left off last week. I gave you a little section to read yourself. And I'm in Acts chapter 18, verse 24. Start with this. Jesus, what's he over? He's over this. Jesus over religiosity. Okay? Man, just religion. Nothing worse in this world than religion. Down with religion. Everybody vote for religion. All right? Down with religion, man. Religion is man-made efforts to get to God. Religion is man self-styling, making up his own ideas. I'll get to God somehow. It's not affecting anything. It's not helpful. It's a big waste of time. Any genuine Christian should hate religion. We hate religion. Christianity is not a religion. It's a relationship, all right? It's God reaching down to us through his son, Jesus Christ. The initiative's not ours making something up, all right? The initiative's God reaching down in truth through his son to redeem us. And so down with religion. Notice that in the text, John 18:24. Now a Jew named Apollos, a native of Alexandria, came to Ephesus. You see that there? You looking at it? All right? Who's this Apollos guy? Well, actually, he's mentioned 10 times in the New Testament. He was a contemporary of the Apostle Paul, and he could have been a competitor of the Apostle Paul. I mean, they flat out loved this Apollos guy in Corinth. They were crazy about him, so much so that when Paul wrote to Corinth in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, Paul had to kind of straighten them out about not following the man but following the message. He says, there's jealousy and strife among you, and you're behaving in a human way. One says, I follow Paul. Another says, I follow Apollos. He says, what then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants through whom you believed. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. All right? So this Apollos guy, well, no wonder Paul was a little insecure. Notice what it says about him in Acts 18. So Apollos came to Ephesus. He was an eloquent man. NIV says learned. It means literally a man of words. He had knowledge and the ability or the capacity to articulate what he knew. So he wasn't just like a studied guy, but he could tell you and explain it to you. He was an eloquent man. And then notice it says in the text, he was competent in the scriptures. All right? And New American Standard says he was mighty in the scriptures. Look up here. Apollos was a guy who knew how to handle this book. All right? He knew what it said, and he knew how to say it to people in a way that would impact their life. So he was eloquent, competent in the scriptures. Notice also it says that he was fervent. He had been instructed in the way of the Lord, and he was being fervent in spirit. All right? The guy had zeal. Apollos had passion. He was fired up. I mean, nobody wants to listen to a boring preacher. That was a great spot for an amen. I mean, nobody wants to listen to a boring preacher, man. I mean, if the preacher's not fired up, nobody else is going to be, right? And so Apollos, but that wasn't a problem with him. He was fervent in spirit. And notice it says that he taught accurately the things concerning Jesus, verse 25. And what a guy. I mean, eloquent, competent in the scriptures, fervent in spirit, teaching accurately. I mean, if we had been there, we'd have been like, wow, this Apollos guy, man, he's like the next Billy Graham. I mean, he's going to be the Apostle Paul. This guy's unbelievable. But here's what you need to know. He was unsaved, okay? He was just a religious guy. He didn't know Jesus personally. And I want you to know that in our culture and in our church, Jesus trumps religiosity. Just people who have the information, but they don't have a personal thing with Jesus. And I can't answer for the church down the street or the church around the corner, but I want you to know, I hope and pray that if Apollos comes to our church, that we're not going to let him get by just because he knows some stuff and he can talk good. All right? And in most churches, we'd be rushing that guy up front. We'd be like, let's hear from him. Let's have him give a testimony or something like that. But he's not saved, okay? He doesn't really, notice that it says in the text, he spoke and taught accurately the things concerning Jesus, though he knew only the baptism of John. So he only knew about John. He only knew about there's a Messiah coming. He only knew about Jesus in the Old Testament prophesied. He didn't have a personal thing with Jesus. He was a religious guy, all right? Now, if you were to come to most churches, they'd be like, oh, come on, leave him alone. He's sincere. He's got a heart. He's fervent. Give him some space. What are you messing with him for? Just leave him alone. Wish that most people were as fired up as Apollos, okay? But at the end of the day, the guy is unsaved, and that's a problem. All right, and we don't want our church to become a harbor for people who have a religiousness, but they don't have a personal relationship with Jesus. Isn't that right? All right, you got to have a real thing with him. And if we could talk to Apollos, what we would want to say to them? Notice in the text that Aquila and Priscilla talked to him. Apollos began, verse 26, began to speak boldly in the synagogue, but when Priscilla and Aquila heard him, they took him and explained to him the way of God more accurately. What do you think they said to him? I'll bet you they said to him stuff like, hey, Apollos, okay, it's nice that you got all this Bible information in your head, all right, but is it in your heart, all right? Because it's not enough just to know stuff about Jesus, Apollos. Do you know that God loves you personally, you, he loves you? Do you know that he gave his son, Jesus Christ, to die so that your sins could be forgiven? And do you know that you have to receive personally the gift of eternal life? You can't just go to church and carry a Bible and stuff. You got to make it your own. You got to embrace Jesus Christ by faith yourself, Apollos. Hey, let me ask you this way. If you were to die tonight, Apollos, God forbid that you'd walk out of here and be struck by a car or something awful and sudden would happen to you. If you were to die and stand before God, and the Bible says that's what happens to everybody who dies, they stand before God. Hebrews 9 says it's appointed unto man once to die, and after this comes judgment. And hey, Apollos, if you were to die and you were to stand before God and he were to say to you, why should I let you into heaven? Because that's what God is going to say. He's going to be like, why should I let you into heaven? Well, what we're wondering, Apollos, is what would your answer be? Because if your answer would be like, well, I was a pretty good guy, and I went to church, and I had 3 Bibles and a New Testament that I kept in my glove compartment, and I wasn't as mean as the old lady across the street, and I never killed anybody, because if you would make any reference to your own performance as why God should let you into heaven, not saved. Not saved, Apollos, just a religious guy, okay? Nothing in my hands I bring, only to your cross I cling. The only answer that will satisfy God on that day, the only answer that will keep you from hearing the awful final words, depart from me, I never knew you. The only thing that will keep that is a total and complete faith in Jesus Christ as the only basis for my forgiveness. Nothing else will get this done, do you understand? Nothing else will make it. Religious people, Baptist churches and Presbyterian churches and Episcopal churches and Bible churches and Catholic churches are filled with religious people who don't know Jesus personally, who cannot look to a time in their life when they turn from their sin and embrace Jesus Christ by faith as the only basis for their forgiveness. Look, if you don't have a conversion story, you don't have a conversion. All right? And let's vote again. What do we think about religion? All right, down with religion and up with a personal, genuine, life-changing relationship with Jesus Christ. You say, well, I hope I have that. Well, I believe Apollos got it big time here between verse 26 and 27 because they explained the way of God to him more accurately. And when he wished to cross to Achaia, the brothers encouraged him and wrote to the disciples to welcome him. And when he arrived, he greatly helped those who through grace had believed. So he's even helping Christians now and discipling them and stuff. So the guy's totally saved. For he powerfully refuted the Jews in public, showing, that means demonstrating by the scriptures, that the Christ was Jesus. Now, into chapter 19, same problem, religiosity, different group of people. Chapter 19, verse 1, and it happened that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul passed through the inland country and came to Ephesus. There he found some disciples. And he said to them, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? And they were like, no, we haven't even, what'd you say? Do we receive the Holy what? No, we've not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit, saved or unsaved. Unsaved. 1 Corinthians 12:13 says that by one Spirit were we all baptized into one body. That when you turn from your sin and embrace Jesus Christ by faith, the Holy Spirit comes to live within you. Look, and it changes your life. If any man is in Christ, if any woman is in Christ, if any person is in Christ, the old things are passing away and everything's becoming new. Look up here. This is really, really important. All right? Are you saved? Are you saved, or are you just a religious person? Because if you're saved, the Holy Spirit comes to live in you. A man came up last night and asked one of our elders, and he was saying, you know, you got to pray for me. I keep having these feelings of suicide. And he said to him, well, are you saved? And he said, well, I heard about Jesus a few years ago at a rally or something. And he said, well, tell me about what happened. He said, well, I cried. He said, well, let me ask you, are you still slave to sin? He said, yeah, I still am. He said, do you still take the Lord's name in vain? He said, yeah, I still do. He says, you're not saved. And he prayed with him right there to have a genuine personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Down with religion, up with a genuine personal relationship with Jesus Christ. These people weren't saved because they didn't have the Holy Spirit. Now, this is the key. When you really get saved, you get the Holy Spirit, and that changes everything. You say, well, what does it change? Well, here's some things it changes. Number one, you get a hunger for God's Word. The Spirit of God gives you a hunger for God's Word. You say, well, there's a time in my life, man, when reading the Bible was like reading the encyclopedia, man. It didn't mean nothing to me. I couldn't care less about it. It didn't make sense. I didn't understand it, and it was boring, and I didn't want to do it, not in any way. But Then I gave my life to Christ, and I got this appetite for God's word, and I was reading it and memorizing it and studying it, and I was passionate about it. Do you get it? Because if God's word is just like some boring encyclopedia to you, that's a very bad sign, because when God's spirit's in you, he's yearning for and longing for the truth. Okay, here's a second characteristic. When you come to know Jesus Christ personally, the Spirit of God comes to live within you, and you get the gifts of the Spirit. You get supernatural capacities to serve God, and you get the fruit of the Spirit, which is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, self-control, Ephesians 5, 21 and 22. Your life's changing. Your character's changing. You also get the conviction of sin. You're like, man, before I was really born again, before I was saved, I could sin my face off. I could do all kinds of things and act like a fool. I'd just wake up the next day, the sun shining, off I go into the world again. I was a sinning machine. But then when I came to Christ, man, I got convicted. And if I treated somebody harshly, I felt bad about it. I had to go out and tell them I was sorry. And if I went certain places or did certain things, I got convicted about it. And I felt so guilty. And so, how many people know what I'm talking about? All right? That's the Spirit of God living in you. That's why he was asking them the right question, these religious people. And when he found some disciples there, he said to them, did you receive the Holy Spirit? And they're like, we don't even know what that is. And he said, into what then were you baptized? And they said, into John's baptism. Religion. Okay? Amazingly, 25 years after John was beheaded by Herod, hundreds of miles from the place that happened, here were some of John's disciples. Well, they weren't listening to John very carefully, because John's whole thing was, I'm nothing. Jesus is everything. He must increase. I must decrease. I don't even get to tie his shoes up. I'm so nothing. It's all about Jesus. But they were maybe waiting for that. Paul said, verse 4, John baptized with the baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in the one. Did you listen to what he said? Because he said there was one to come after him. That is Jesus. Well, they must have been sincere, verse 5, because on hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Saved? Huh? They went from Jesus over sincere religiosity. Now, in our church, we'd be like, look at these people. They're so sincere. Just leave them alone. In our culture, we'd be like, oh, far be it from me, and who am I to judge? And he seems sincere, and to each his own, and blah, blah, blah. That's what the culture says. But what Jesus says is, cut the nonsense. No playing games here. Jesus trumps religiosity. And we can accommodate ourselves as Christians to a lot of believers who believe a lot of different things. But if you don't have the Spirit of God living within you, if you're not truly saved, all right, I hope you'll make the choice today to come from death unto life. And then by application, this point, as you begin to think about confronting your culture and the people that you know and you care about, all right, hey, listen up. Doesn't matter if your mom goes to church or not, all right? If she doesn't love the Word of God, if she's not growing in worship, if she doesn't love Jesus, what I'm telling you is she's not saved, okay? And you can't comfort yourself because of her sincere religiousness. And maybe your sister's not saved either, really. And the Lord knows those that are his. And I'm not telling you how to judge people or come to assessments. I'm just telling you, don't rest in their religiousness. And keep pressing on yourself and upon others the genuine demonstration of a real faith in Jesus, evidenced by the fruits of the Spirit at work in your life. Jesus over religiosity. Here's the second thing. Completely different, but moving through the text. Jesus over stubborn unbelief. Verse 5, on hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul had laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them. Yeah, like with everybody who gets saved. And they began speaking in tongues and prophesying. I've taught on this before, but those are just two of the many evidences of the Spirit at work in your life. And all the gifts of the Spirit and all the fruits of the Spirit. The Spirit came upon them. There were about 12 men in all. And after he entered the synagogue, and for 3 months, now notice in verse 8, he entered the synagogue and for 3 months spoke boldly, reasoning and persuading them about the kingdom of God. Notice those three things. Boldly, that's clear, direct, candor in the face of opposition. That's what we do. We confront the culture. Not mean, not I'm going to shove this down your throat, but just clear, direct. It's not strategic. It's not clever. It's not subtle. It's just, I got to tell you about Jesus Christ and about what he loves you and what he can do in your life. Boldly, and then notice reasoning. Underline that in your Bible. It's also in 17:2, Acts 17:17, Acts 18:4. The Greek is Dialegomai, it means dialogue, rational discourse. Not pounding people with the gospel, but just lovingly, graciously, directly explaining to people. You owe a debt you can't pay. He paid a debt he didn't owe. All right? He'll forgive your sins and give you the gift of eternal life. I mean, just plainly, clearly explaining the gospel to people. That's what Paul was doing. Boldly reasoning. Oh, yeah, but notice also in the text, persuading. I think postmodernism in our culture can handle a certain amount of reasoning and discussing. But when you start persuading, when you start pressing people about it, you got to make a decision, buddy. I'm not offering you plan B here, all right? There's one way that leads to eternal life. It's a narrow road. Only a few are finding it. There's a broad road. It leads to destruction. Everyone's going that way, and you got to make a decision. You start persuading people, they're like, what are you talking about, man? That might work for you, but that doesn't work for me. And, you know, if that's like scratches where you itch, rock on, you know. But for me, that's really not where I'm coming. You know what I'm talking about? How many people know what I'm talking about? All right? But it's not just a matter of just talking like Jesus is some worthy to be considered alternative. All right? There is right, there is wrong. There is light, there is darkness. There is narrow road, there is broad road. There is one way that leads to eternal life. All right? And this is the gospel. And we boldly reason with and persuade people, which gives me an opportunity to say this, because I think people sometimes misunderstand what's happening right now. I want you to know that my confident persuasion and bold proclamation of God's here on a weekly basis, I hope you know and you'll believe me when I tell you that that is not flowing from some arrogant personal confidence that I have. In fact, I would just share with you that the responsibility of standing up and teaching you God's word week by week, and I know that Joe feels the same way, it is an overwhelming task, and it is the great point of humility and brokenness in my life. The time that it takes to prepare to feed these hungry hearts on a weekly basis. And if I seem confident, my confidence is in the Word of God. And if I seem assertive and strong about it, it's because these are matters of life and death and eternal urgency. Do you understand? And notice Paul. So he was reasoning and persuading them about the kingdom of God, verse 9. But when some became stubborn, the word stubborn there, New American Standard and New King James say hardened. I like the NIV translation. It says obstinate, you know, like a mule. So he's preaching the word, but some of them are like obstinate. It's a medical term. It's only used here in Acts, but in Hebrews, it's the word translated, do not harden your heart. They became obstinate, and notice in the text, and they continued in unbelief. They're like, yeah, well, that's what you say. We don't believe it. They continued in unbelief, and if that's not bad enough, it's one thing not to know, but it's worse when you know and you don't believe it. But it's worse still when you know and don't believe it, and you recruit other people not to believe it. Notice they were speaking evil of the way before the congregation. So it wasn't enough to just sit there and say, I don't believe it. You were reaching across the aisle and saying to other people, don't believe this man, don't do it, don't go there. That's a lot to answer for, and that's what they were doing to the point where Paul was like, you know what, forget you people. And he withdrew from them and took the disciples with him. He's like, you know what? You don't want it. You don't want it. You think you're better than this. You think you don't need this. I'm going to go tell somebody else. Look, that's a very important principle. All right? Don't keep pressing the gospel on someone who flat out says, I don't want this. All right? Say, fine, you know. Shake the dust off your feet and go on to somebody else. Maybe God will ripen them to the gospel later. They're not ready now. And so they moved on. And he actually, notice it says that he reasoned daily in the hall of Tyrannus. That's no longer standing, but archaeologists who have excavated the city of Ephesus know its location. And this continued for 2 years. Actually, 1 Corinthians 16:8, Paul says, I will stay in Ephesus. A wide door of effective ministry has opened for me, but there are many adversaries. So even though this was an awesome place for Paul to do ministry and many people were coming to know Christ and a lot of people were getting saved, there was also a lot of opposition. But he stayed there for 2 more years. Notice in verse 10, so that all the residents of Asia heard the word of the Lord, both Jews and Greeks. So everyone was like really digging on this, and their lives were getting totally impacted. And look up here. But some of them were very stubborn. Do you get it? Some of the people were very stubborn. Some of the people were so responsive to the good news, but some of the people were very stubborn. And I can't explain that to you, why some people seem to respond and some people are so stubborn, okay? But it's the way it really is. But here's what I want you to have. I want you to have faith to believe that no matter how stubborn the person you've been sharing with about Jesus, that in God's time they can get saved, All right? It's never too late. It doesn't matter how resistant they seem to the gospel. God can crack the hardest rock. He really can. And which reminds me to tell you about this guy in our church who, you know, I hope we never get over how many people are getting saved in our church. Do you know how many people are getting saved in our church? I mean, it is out of control. All right? It's a work of God. I've never been part of anything where so many people are coming to know Christ. And I hope we never take for granted the harvesting of souls that is coming and growing and increasing, so much so that people are always wanting to get baptized in our church and on our three campuses and so on now with all these thousands of people. We can't always let each one of you hear every baptism. And people get baptized in other services, you're not here. And they get baptized at other campuses, you'll never even meet them. But all the stories are amazing. But there was this one story from a couple of weeks ago that I really want you to hear, of this guy who would always sit at the 9 o'clock service right about where you are, right about there or maybe there. And I know because he sat in the same seat every week, just like most of you do. And it'd be funny if you all showed up at the same service some week and just like, that's my seat. No, you're here at the wrong time. And so he would always sit over there. This guy came to our church for 12 years, hard to the gospel. I mean, for 12 years. He came to one of the very first party at the pastor's. Remember when we lived in Arlington Heights? He came to one of the very first party at the pastor's, and he came into the house with his wife, and he's like, yeah, I'm here because of my wife. And I am not, he said this. He said, I'm not saved. I said, well, we'll pray for you. You could get saved really today. He said, no, not me. I'm not saved. I don't want to be saved. I don't want to be here. It's her. I mean, this went on for years and years and years, but I can't say it better than he can say it, so just listen to this story.
Well, this is another person I've been excited for you to meet. I've known him for a long time, and he's got a very interesting story. This is Shell Arison, and Shell, tell us how you came to know Jesus Christ.
Well, I don't know exactly how it happened, but...
That's probably good.
I know. We were here at services about 3 years ago. Sunday service, and you were preaching, and like you usually do at times, you ask people if they're ready to accept the Lord to stand up. Well, everybody else is praying, they got their head down, and stand up and say the prayer. Well, I had no intention of standing up. I hadn't thought about it.
Can I just cut in right there?
Yes.
Not only had he had no intention, but he had, at that point, 12 years. Be encouraged, wives of unbelieving spouses. Tara, your wife would come, bring you to church every week. She'd sing on our worship team, and you'd sit out here in this section, and I knew you didn't know Christ, and I can't count the number of times that I prayed for Shell as I was giving the gospel, and he resolutely would not choose Christ. But it all changed that day, didn't it?
Yes, it did. The week before, as he walked down the aisle, he kicked my leg off and knocked it off into the aisle, so I knew
You do what you can.
Yeah.
So tell us about that day then. So you heard the gospel, you weren't planning to stand up, but tell us what happened.
I found myself standing up, and I've thought about it a lot since, and I think the Lord just said, Shell, enough's enough, grabbed me by the collar and pulled me up.
Amen.
That's what happened.
Amen.
So.
Amen.
There it was.
Amen. And we've been seeing, you're Jewish, and we've been seeing in the book of Acts a lot about the conversion of Jewish people, and it's an amazing thing for you to find Jesus Christ. Personally, it's been awesome, and you know what has blessed my heart, Shell,
is
the weeks and the years that I saw you barely, hardly singing, and to now see you the first person up on your feet and enthusiastically singing praise to the Lord in every service. It's really been an awesome testimony. Tell us why you want to be baptized.
Well, I want everybody to know that I want to profess my faith to Jesus, and I want to live my life for him. I trust him. I love him. I know I have a long way to go, but I know he's waiting for me.
Amen. Isn't that awesome?
So,
take my hand. Well, Shell, you have publicly professed your faith in Jesus Christ. It's a great joy and a privilege for me to baptize you now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Thank you, James.
Beautifully God bless you.
And listen, here's the point of all of that, all right? I want you to have faith to believe that there is no person that you know and love that God can't get the good news to them. And don't think to yourself, oh, they're too hard, they're too far, they'll never come around, they'll never get it. Listen, Jesus is over all of that. He is bigger than any of that. We don't need to be clever, cool, or strategic, or compromised, or any of that, man. Just get the word out. Get the good news out and pray. Think about that faithful wife for 12 years bringing that guy to church. I'm sure he was a handful and more. and just loving him and praying for him. And to see the joy in her face last night, she was singing in our gospel choir this morning. And she has a lot to sing about, all right? And he is able to save to the uttermost, we learned in the book of Hebrews. And no one is beyond the reach of the gospel. And we don't need to be on our heels as we confront the culture, all right? Jesus Christ himself, by the power of his word, and by his testimony, is confronting the culture. Jesus over religiosity. Jesus over stubborn unbelief. Now, very seriously, Jesus over satanic strongholds. Look with me at verse 11. And God was doing extraordinary miracles by the hand of Paul. Do you see that there in verse 11? God was doing extraordinary miracles. Does that seem like a redundancy to anyone? Extraordinary miracles. As opposed to what kind? It's sort of like fast speed. That is fast speed you got going there. But you know, I thought about it a little bit, and what he's really saying here is even in the category of miracles, these are super miracles. They're extraordinary miracles, never seen before, never seen since. God was doing extraordinary miracles by the hand of Paul. I think it's important to understand that, because sadly a lot of people have tried to imitate verse 12 here. So that even handkerchiefs or aprons that had touched his skin were carried away to the sick, and their diseases left them, and the evil spirits came out of them. Wow. And all God's people said, wow. Because that was, how many people believe that was really happening? I mean, I'm telling you, this guy was so on fire for God, and God's Spirit was so working through him uniquely at that time in church history, that if you had like a handkerchief or something, and you could just touch it to the Apostle Paul, you could take it right to a sick person, and they'd be healed. Wow. But the problem comes, as I've said to you many times, we should experience the apostles' teaching, not teach the apostles' experience. Because when people try to just turn on late-night televangelism, here's a letter from a recent televangelist who said, quote, "Now I'm obeying the Holy Spirit and loaning you this blessed handkerchief by faith. I use the word loan because I must have it back as soon as possible. In fact, here's what I ask you to do in Jesus' name. Print your name by faith in the center of my handkerchief. And next, open your Bible to Acts 19, 11, and 12. Then lay my faith handkerchief with your name printed in the center on it. Leave it there overnight. And then the next morning, mail it back to me in this self-addressed stamped envelope. I will pay for the postage. Rush my faith handkerchief back to me. And with the largest bill or check that you can give," and he lists the suggested amounts for the gifts, And give it as an act of faith, obey the Holy Spirit, and God's blessing will be bestowed upon you. Okay? I'm not even saying that the person who wrote that isn't sincere. I have no idea what their motives are, but they're wrong. That's why the scripture goes out of its way to say, and God was doing extraordinary, never seen to that day, never seen since. God still does miracles, amen? But let's don't try to imitate the things in the Bible. That'd be the same as saying to people, we're going to mail them out. We're going to mail you out David's slingshot to conquer the giants in your life. We're going to mail you out Moses' rod so you can part the waters in front. All right. Verse 13. Then some of the itinerant Jewish exorcists... It's like a word puzzle. The what? Yeah, the Jewish itinerant exorcists. Exorcists are people who cast out demons. I didn't know there was any Jewish ones, let alone that they traveled and did this everywhere. But anyway, then some of the itinerant Jewish exorcists undertook to invoke the name of the Lord Jesus over those who had evil spirits. So they weren't saved. They were Jewish, but they were trying to cast out spirits. In the New Testament times, when anyone tried to cast out an evil spirit, they tried to do it in the name of a deity. Of course, it never worked because the deities were all like made up. And so when they actually saw that Paul had power over evil spirits by the name of Jesus, all the itinerant Jewish exorcists were like, well, we should do the Jesus thing. And so they said, I adjure you by the name, by Jesus whom Paul proclaims, because they didn't know anything about him himself. So can you imagine, they're talking to an evil spirit, and they're like, you need to come out of this person because of the Jesus that he talks about. That is such a bad plan. Verse 14, seven sons of a Jewish high priest named Sceva were doing this. It's always the way with the sons, right? Sometimes the sons think that they have the Without the education of the father, without the experience of the father, without the effort of the father, these sons were like, yeah, well, our dad's the high priest. And we heard this Paul guy talking about Jesus. So these guys were so unauthentic. They were riding on their father's coattails. They were riding on the apostle Paul. So get this, verse 15. It would be funny if it wasn't so tragic. So the evil spirit answers them, Jesus I know, Paul I recognize. Say it. What's it say? Just read it. Go ahead. Who? I was like, who are you? Now get this. And the man in whom was the evil spirit leaped on them, the seven sons of Sceva, and mastered all of them. I used to think it was the evil spirit, but it wasn't. It was the man that was demon-possessed. The spirit was in him. And so I want you just to think about 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 people. And the one guy, demon-possessed, takes all, it's like cage match. Takes all of you out completely. It's going to be hard to even imagine that. But the power of the satanic being within him, he mastered all of them. Notice it says in the text, he overpowered them, so they fled out of the house naked. Probably not like butt naked, but in the New Testament time, if you just had off your outer clothes, it was such a shame for the Hebrews. They covered themselves. You can picture them with their outer robes and their inner robes and naked and wounded. And, hey, a little bit about spiritual warfare here as a review, okay? And just jot a couple things down. Satan is real and powerful, all right? He is real and he is powerful. He's known by many names, all of which reveal something about his character. He's called Satan 36 times, which means adversary. It means that he is the one, he's our opponent, he's the one who's fighting against us. He's called the devil 35 times in Scripture, which means slanderer. And he slanders us before God the Father, and we have no place to stand apart from Jesus Christ's intercession on our behalf. He's called the evil one 10 times. He's called the tempter. He's called Beelzebub, which means lord of the flies, 7 times. He's called Belial, which means worthlessness. He's called the ruler of this world, the prince of the power of the air. Satan is called the accuser of the brethren, the father of lies. He's called the serpent, and he's called the dragon. Now, Satan and his demons are such a common theme in the New Testament, more than 250 references. Actually, Satan is mentioned in the New Testament more than once per chapter, all right? More than once per chapter. He is a real foe. Now, he is not our only enemy. Some people get onto this demon behind every bush and the spirit of lust and the spirit of envy and this hyper-demonism, but he is real. Everyone say real. All right, he's real. Our three enemies, according to Scripture, are the world system, the culture, we're talking about that today, the flesh, that's me, myself, my own pride and my own sinful bent, and then the devil. Those are our three enemies, the world, the flesh, the devil. But Satan is certainly part of that. He is real. And then notice, secondly, he is powerful. Satan's not everything that some people make of him, but he's not nothing. 1 Peter 5:8 says that Satan is like a roaring lion. The lion in the ancient world was the most feared predator, the one most likely to catch his prey. And so Satan is like a roaring lion. He's not sleeping, he's angry. And he's walking about, the scripture says, not laying in the sun, not searching for food. He's seeking people to devour. 1 Peter 5:8, he's seeking people to devour, not to hinder, not to harm slightly. He's looking to ravenously consume you. He's looking to destroy your marriage and your family. He's looking to consume and devour your victory and your joy and all the good things that we find in Christ. Satan is real and he is powerful. Many people ask me this frequently, and so I repeat this from a previous teaching. People ask, can a Christian be demon-possessed? Well, can a Christian be demon-possessed? Can a Christian be demon-possessed? The question itself is a misnomer. All right, the word possessed is not even in the original writings of the New Testament. That's something that was added by the translators. The word demonizomai is the idea of being demonized. Demonized. Can a Christian be demonized? Can a Christian be tempted, oppressed, pressured, pushed by it? Absolutely. In fact, I would suggest to you that it has nothing to do with spatial language. It's not, can a demon be inside me, outside me, upside me, downside? It's not an inside-outside thing. It's about control. And can a Christian be controlled by the enemy? The answer is yes. Romans 6 says, to whom you yield your members, slaves to obey, you are that one's slaves whom you obey. And if Satan tempts you to do something and you do it, and he tempts you to do something else and you do it, if you do what Satan tempts you to do, you're his slave. And in that sense, you're controlled by him. Here's the point. A believer cannot be controlled by Satan against his will. All right. Greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world. The only ground that Satan has is the ground that you give him. And in Christ, you have the authority to take that ground back. Amen? All right. So can a believer be demon-possessed? Wrong question. Can a believer be demonized? Paul told the Ephesians not to give Satan a foothold. Paul told Timothy to correct those who are in error so they may escape the snare of the devil, having been held captive by him to do his will, 2 Timothy 2:26. Paul warned Timothy that in latter times people would fall away from the faith, paying attention to deceitful spirits and doctrines of demons. 1 Timothy 4, welcome to our day. There are many degrees of demonization, all of which are possible for the believer. Paul said we should not let sin or Satan reign in our mortal bodies, not present ourselves as instruments of unrighteousness. All right. Well, back to the text then. You're like, well, this kind of stinks here. I mean, gosh, like they got mastered, they got overpowered, they were naked and wounded when they left the house. Man, we're really taking it a beating here. Yeah, well, a couple things. First of all, the sons of Sceva were not on our team, okay? Those guys weren't on our team. They're totally unsaved. They're playing for the enemy team. And they got what was coming to them. They were messing around with something they didn't know what they were involved in. And then secondly, the story's not over yet. Notice these four great results even of this spiritual warfare that God allowed. Verse 17, and this became known to all the residents of Ephesus, both Jews and Greeks, and fear fell upon them. That's the first benefit. There's four of them. Fear fell upon them. Look up here for a minute. I can't think of anything I'd rather have for our church than to have it be said that in the summer of 07, great fear came upon all of them. Fear is the attitude of heart that wants to be in a right relationship with God. Fear, the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. The fear of God is, you know what, I can't just do anything I want any way I want and act any way I want. I'm going to pay the consequences if I do that. I've got to be on the program. I got to be really careful about the choices that I make, or I'm going to suffer the consequences of disobeying God. That's the fear of God. That was one of the positive results. And then it says that the name of Jesus was extolled. Every time I see like that and something like that in Scripture, it just excites me so much. That's what every one of us should want as a follower of Jesus Christ. I bought this flag to just sort of illustrate this. This is the Christian flag. And this is what I think about when I think about the name of Jesus being extolled, you know, just waving this Christian flag. Don't you want the name of Jesus Christ extolled over every single situation in your life? Isn't there something inside you that gets so excited when you think about, I was at work this week and my boss did an awful thing to me, but I handled it this way and the name of Jesus Christ was extolled. Isn't that awesome? And here this awful spiritual warfare was going on, and these imposters were trying to cast out demons in the name of a Jesus they didn't even know. But somehow, by God's grace, fear came upon them all, and the name of Jesus Christ was extolled. Isn't that what we want for our lives? Amen? Isn't that what we want for our church? Now, that's two awesome things that happen, but notice these other two things that happen too. It also says in the text that believers were confessing their secret sin. Now, believers, people that knew Christ but still had things from the world sort of hanging over. And many of those who were now believers came confessing and divulging their practices. And a number of those who had practiced magic arts brought their books together and burned them in the sight of all. So they had some like old world, you know what I'm talking about? You come to Christ but you still have some of the ways of the world hanging around in your life. You know what I mean? Put up your hand if you know what I mean. Put up your neighbor's hand because they won't be able to be honest about that. All right? Do you know what I mean? And some of the ways of the world are still kind of hanging around, and they're like, you know what? I'm embarrassed to say it, but I still read that, what do you call that thing in the newspaper with the 12 different things? And yeah, the horoscope. I still read the horoscope, you say, and I don't know why I do it. Well, you shouldn't do it, all right? That's the world. That's paganism. You know, my mother-in-law, when I'm over there, sometimes she gets out this Ouija board, and she's like so into it. Creepy man, satanic, run for the hills, okay? And some of the people, they'd come to know Christ, and whatever they were, they still had some of their old pagan practices involved, but not anymore. A number of those who had practiced magic arts brought their books together and burned them in the sight of all, and they counted the value of them and found it came to 50,000 pieces of silver, which won't be especially helpful now that they've burned them. 50,000, one piece of silver was a day's wage, so that's 50,000 days' wages, millions of dollars in today's standards. So that's the third result. Believers were confessing their secret sin. And then fourthly, notice, so the word of the Lord continued to increase and prevail mightily. That's the essence of biblical ministry, is that the word of God is prevailing mightily. And the word of God is growing and gaining greater influence. Don't you want the word of God to get greater influence in your life? That more and more and more the word of God would have control over me and the life that I live and the choices I make. I love that. The word of God was prevailing, leveling every ungodly obstacle in its path. Jesus over satanic strongholds. Now, as good as it is for Jesus to be over satanic strongholds in Ephesus, how many people think it would be a little better if Jesus was over satanic strongholds here in Chicago and at my house and at your house? So I jotted a couple of thoughts down. Jot these five things. Jesus over my strongholds. How about that, huh? How about Jesus over the strongholds at my house? And if he has power over satanic strongholds, how about this first one? Jesus over fleshly entertainment. There is a way of entertaining yourself as a Christian, but it's really worldly. It doesn't feed your spirit. It doesn't feed your new man. It grieves God's spirit within you. It just pleases your flesh. And it doesn't grow you up in Christ. It doesn't make you into the person you want. It just feeds your flesh. And some Christians, listen, Satan has a stronghold in your life about worldly entertainment. And you need to break that and get on into the good things that God has for you. Kathy and I took a recommendation from someone recently and went to a movie. And I'm telling you, we were like 1 minute, 2 minute, we are out of here. And we literally ran out of the theater. It was so worldly. And God help us as the followers of Jesus from giving Satan a foothold in our life through worldly entertainment. Now, entertainment's not wrong. Everyone say it's not wrong. All right, but if it's feeding my flesh and cultivating sinful practices in me, it can become a satanic stronghold. Here's a second one, unbelief. Just a refusal to believe and act upon God's word. Just not doing it. Just not living under God's word. Just not doing what God's word says. Just not living as God has commanded us to live. And you know what the word of God says, but you don't do what it says. And that is a satanic stronghold, to think that there's some benefit that's going to happen to you because you came and sat here today. The only benefit that will happen to you is if you act on the things that are being taught and talked about. If you don't go do anything differently, just hearing the word but not believing it, that's a stronghold for sure. A lot of people are trapped in that. Here's a third one, unforgiveness. Forgiveness is the decision to release a person from the obligation that resulted when they injured me. And when I won't forgive, when I choose not to forgive, that's a satanic stronghold. Ephesians 4 talks about, through unforgiveness, giving Satan a foothold, a place to stand in your life. And someone did something to me, and I'm not letting it go, and I'll never forget that, and I'm keeping track of it. Listen, I'm not even saying it wasn't awful. It might have been the height of wickedness. But the way for you out of that dark cave is forgiveness. Be tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ has forgiven you, Ephesians 4. And remember, Jesus told the parable about the guy who got forgiven everything, but then he went out and choked the guy for $10. And how wicked that is. And see, if you rightly estimate all that God's forgiven you, then you want to forgive other people. And if you've lost sight of that, if you're harboring unforgiveness in your life, I'm telling you, that is a satanic stronghold that will bring you down. Four. Finances. Finances. Now, it's, as I say always, it's not wrong to have, but it's wrong when things have you. And many believers are in bondage to finances. And you say, what does that look like? Well, counting. How much do I have? How much do I have? How much do I have? How much did I have? How much will I have? Oh, if I just wait 3 more years, I'll have. Counting. And comparing. How much does he have? How much does she have? And why don't I have as much as she has? And I think I should have as much as she has by this time because I've been doing as much as she's been doing. And counting and comparing. And then coveting. Oh, I wish I had that. I wish I had that. I'll be happy when I have that. Just a few more months and I'll be able to get that and then I'll be happy. That is a satanic stronghold. Counting and comparing and coveting. You say, well, what should I do with money? Well, try these things. Gain it. Gain it honestly. Grow it wisely. And then give it generously. Right? Those three things break the stronghold of finances in your life. Gain it. God doesn't want you to be a pauper. God doesn't want you to be poor. Work hard. Make a living. gain it honestly, all right, and then grow it wisely. Take what God's given to you and invest it and build it and use it strategically and build wealth. And then, very importantly, give it generously. Don't get too attached to it. Give and give more. And as you get more, give more. Those three things will break the satanic stronghold of finances in your life. And lastly, fear. So many people are in bondage to fear. What's going to happen? And what's up ahead? And am I going to be okay? And what about my kid? And just fear. And what if I don't meet anyone? And fear, just fear, worrying and withdrawing and anxious about the future. God has not given you a spirit of fear. If you have fear, it is not from God. Everyone say, not from God. It's just not from God. It's a satanic stronghold. But Jesus is over satanic strongholds. Amen? Now here's the last thing. Jesus over shallow secularism. These people in this passage are so shallow. Verse 21 through verse 22 talks about a little travel details from Paul. You can read that yourself. But in verse 23, it says, here in Ephesus, about that time there arose no little disturbance concerning the way. For a man named Demetrius, a silversmith, this is in Ephesus. Quick, a little bit about Ephesus. There's no city there now in Turkey where Ephesus was. Let me show you some pictures of Ephesus. These are the ruins of Ephesus. There's a lot more than you can see in that picture. There's buildings. There's marketplace areas. It's unbelievable what's in Ephesus still. Kathy and I have walked up and down those streets, and a number of people in our church have. And because there's no city there, it's all excavated. This is the exact place where the apostle was, one of the biggest cities in the world at that time. And no wonder Paul spent so much time there, and so many other churches were started from his work there. And so back to the text. So this guy who's a silversmith, who made shrines of Artemis. Artemis was the Greek goddess. Her Roman name was Diana. And so these guys, let me show you one of these idols. They've excavated these. This is what the guy made, stuff like that. This is right from that time period. And that's a gold one. He was a silversmith. But they made these idols, okay? And people bought them, and they bowed down to them, and they worshiped them. All right? Now back to the text. This will come quickly now. Anyway, for a man named Demetrius, a silversmith, who made silver shrines of Artemis, brought no little, and that's hyperbole in reverse, it means a great business to the craftsmen. These guys were making it big. So he gathers them together, the workmen in similar trades. It was like a union meeting. And he's like, all right, we're the Artemis Silversmith Union. And man, you know that from this business, we have our wealth. That means prosperity, easy living. And you see and hear and know, not only in Ephesus, but in almost all of Asia, this Paul has persuaded and turned away a great many people saying that gods made with hands are not gods. He's very upset. Do you hear what this Paul's saying? This Paul is a pejorative. This Paul, he's saying that gods made with hands aren't gods. Does that upset any of you? Do you hear what he's saying? He's saying that these gods that we've made, that they're not really gods. I spent a lot of time on my God. I was down in my basement for hours carving and cutting and pasting and wood and overlaying with gold. And I brought my God, I even gave my God a little earring. And I put him up on the mantle at my house, and I was bowing down to him, and now he's saying that this God I made, he's not a God. What is wrong with you? I mean, how blind is this guy? Yeah, that's what he's saying. He's saying that you didn't make God. But anyway, I don't think he's really worried about the religion part of it. He says, and there is danger not only in that this trade of ours may come into disrepute, there's the money thing again, but also that the temple of the great goddess Artemis may be counted as nothing. She may even be disposed from her magnificence. She whom all Asia and the world, actually, the whole world didn't worship her. He was delusional about that. Verse 28, when they heard this, they were enraged and were crying out, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians!" So the city was filled with the confusion, and they rushed together into the theater, dragging with them Gaius, Aristarchus, Macedonians, who were Paul's companions in travel. So Paul was going to go in too, verse 30. But when Paul wished to go in among the crowd, the disciples would not. They're like, "You're not going in there." And even some of the Asiarchs, that's Asian officials, I guess they were converted because they were giving Paul good counsel too. And they're like, "Dude, you can't go in there, man. You're going to get so killed," urging him not to venture into the theater. Oh, yeah, let me show you this theater. This theater sat like 42,000 people. All right, and we've actually been to this place in Ephesus. There's another picture of it. And so it was like a stadium. And you can imagine, they're like, "Paul, you're not going in there. for the assembly was in confusion. Notice this in verse 32. And most of them did not know why they had come together. Is that ridiculous? All right, so I'll be the one guy, and you be all the crowd, okay? So just start going nuts and making lots of noise about everything. Go ahead. No, like that, like you're arguing. No. And then all of a sudden, one guy's like, why are we here again? I mean, jot this down. Jesus over shallow secularism. Shallow. It's so shallow. They don't even know what they're doing. They're just all worked up. Isn't that just like our culture? You see this in the newspaper? How many times did that happen this week? I could list off two or three headlines from this week that everyone was really worked up about. And I won't even dignify them by saying them, but you know what I'm talking about. I mean, everyone's so worked up about it. What are we worked up about again? I don't remember. There'll be something else next week. All right? That's shallow secularism. Nothing substantive, nothing meaningful. So much so that some of the crowd prompted Alexander, whom the Jews had put forward, and Alexander, motioning with his hands, wanted to make a defense to the crowd. But when they recognized that he was a Jew, for about 2 hours, they all cried out with one voice, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians!" Until like this town clerk guy, can't you see him with his little glasses and his apron and a pencil behind his ear? The town clerk quiets the crowd and he's like, "Men of Ephesus!" And he makes this big speech, blah, blah, blah. You can read it yourself. But the bottom line is, by verse 40, this guy, he's like, "For we are really in danger of being charged with rioting today. There's no cause that we can give to justify this commotion." And when he said these things, he dismissed the assembly. So for 2 hours, they're screaming, and the guy's like, "We're all going to go to jail for this." And they're like, "Oh, never mind then," and they left. Okay, the key word there is shallow, okay? People get worked up about a lot of things, but Jesus Christ is the only one worth living for and dying for. Him and his kingdom is the only thing worth giving your life to. I said it at the beginning, and I'll say it at the end. Stand with me. I believe that there is a great harvest of souls coming into our church. And it's because we are not going to be on our heels or backed off into some sort of silent cowardice because of the culture. Man, just make Jesus Christ known. He is what every human heart is longing for. It doesn't matter the religion, Jesus is over that. It doesn't matter the stubbornness of their heart, Jesus is over that. It doesn't matter the satanic strongholds, Jesus is over that. And it doesn't matter their shallow, secular, dead-end, fired-up-about-nothing lives, Jesus is over that. And he can penetrate their hearts by the power of the good news if we would just open our mouths and share it. He's mighty to save. He's mighty to save. Amen. Say that. Say, he's mighty to save. Say it. What is he? He really is. He really is. Let's sing about that. This is our heart.
When everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing, let mercy fall on me. When everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of the Savior, the hope of
Amen. If you're here today and you don't know Christ, what are you waiting for? He loves you. He gave his life for you. He would receive you right now if you would turn to him by faith. And if you're following Jesus, man, get off your heels, all right? Confront the culture lovingly, graciously, kindly, but directly and boldly in the power of God's Spirit. Some will hate, some will resist, some will object, but some will be saved. Lives transformed for all of eternity. This is the work God's calling to us. A harvest is coming. Believe me when I tell you. Pray for it. Work toward it. In fact, go do it this week. All right? You are loved. Have a great week in the Lord.